Good afternoon. Hello, guys. Can you hear me? Okay, great. Okay, sorry for coming late a little bit. So actually my laptop has some problem, so I have to use my desktop. And also with my iPad as an audio input, because my desktop audio effect is not very good. So if there is any issue, then audio video problem, then please let me know, okay? Through the chat box, you can directly speak up. Okay, so let's start. Okay, first thing, let's look at our current, where is my, I thought I opened. Let's log in, okay. Okay, can you guys see my screen? Okay, great. Okay, let me show you. I think in the past week I got several email. So one question is related to the lab. Basically, we don't have a lab exercise in the past few weeks. The reason is that you can see that starting from lab four, basically everything is related to your assignment and assignment two and project, right? So this is why you can directly utilize assignment and project as exercise. So we don't want to give you actual workload, okay? Generally speaking, okay. So then starting from lab six, it goes to assignment three, paper-based, right? Scattering. So basically please do assignment three. Then this week, tutor will deliver tutorial two. You can see verdict here. Tutor already released the material in which he will discuss how to implement a simple scheduling, faithful, particularly show you some data structure and so on. Yeah, give you a start point for you to do additional assignment. We call bonus assignment, right? So I think this is related to another question. One student asked, say, I could not see the bonus. Where is the bonus assignment? Okay, so please go to the blackboard. You can see bonus assignment three has been released. So basically, you can see here, you need to implement multiple level feedback queue. I think the question is clearly defined. Then of course, tutor will discuss a simple one, faithful, first thing, first all. Then you can utilize those data structure, then build upon that to implement. Yeah, so this assignment will be in charge by Zhang Kai, the tutor Zhang Kai. So if you have any question, then please ask him first, okay? Okay, any questions at this moment? Okay. So relate to our assignment two, right? Assignment two. Due last weekend, last Sunday. So I did get several emails about the submission, say that I do have some issue. Can I resubmit and so on? So certainly, I think you can still submit, right? Here, but it will be treated as a late submission. Then, as we mentioned before, we can only grade based on what you submit in the Blackboard. Okay, so don't send me email, say that, can I submit through the email? No, 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 you just submit through the system. Yeah, if you want to take the late submission penalty, it's okay, yeah. So I hope this is clear, okay? But of course, this is related to the fairness. Then we cannot see you have some you want to have some privilege. Sorry, okay. So everyone need to be fairly treated in this class. Okay. Okay, so I guess that's all I want to announced before we talk about our lecture. Okay, so yeah, so now I move to the lecture nine, the slides, lecture nine, virtualizing memory, address space, and address translation. So first thing, can you guys see the slides and hear me clearly? Everything is okay, right? Okay, thank you guys, okay, yeah. So first, this is your assignment four, basically. So similar to the assignment three, we also have one paper-based assignment, which relates to the memory management, and also one bonus program-related assignment. Okay, so then if you want to know more about the grade distribution, then go back to the first set of slides, right? Introduction to course introduction, then you can see the how we do assessment. Okay, so we are still inside memory, you're inside the process here. So basically, the previous part, we discussed scheduling, so how to generate a process and how, but mainly we talk about do scheduling after a very brief introduction about the process and the several the structures, then we go to the scheduling. Today, we go to the one for most important topic related to a process creation, address space. Okay, generally speaking, we need to allocate physical memory in order to run a program, right? Based on Feynman architecture, we have to load our program and data into the memory. Then basically we can fetch the instruction from memory or load the stored data from memory, right? So the problem here is that we have multiple processes, which is a multiple running program at the same time. Then how we share the limited memory resource. Okay, that's the issue we want to handle. Okay, you can see here, we talk about memory virtualization, okay? So generally speaking, we want to provide the illusion for each process. See, okay, you are the only one to run in the system, you own the whole memory, something like that, okay? But realistically, it's impossible, right? So basically, we we have to share our memory. So why we want to do this memory virtualization? Of course, we want to, certainly we don't have enough memory, enough physical memory, that's one issue. However, we also have additional benefit. For example, the first thing, it's very easy for programming. Okay? Then you say, so what? So you do the virtualization, then you can make a programmer life easier? I don't think so, but that's true. Okay, I will show you later, okay? So certainly we want to manage memory in terms of time and space. When we do this kind of memory allocation, memory management, we have to efficiently use our memory, okay? Then also a very important issue is that we want to isolate, okay, process, okay? So basically, if a malicious process want to access other process space, then we want to provide the protection, okay? Also, we don't want user level program to touch operating system. So generally speaking, that's the purpose. That's the benefit we can get from the memory virtualization. So in old days, you can see in old days, actually, we can only run one program or one process. For example, our operating system is from 0 to 64 kilobytes. The other part is one program we can load into, then we can run it. Okay. So it's very poor in terms of utilization and efficiency. Okay? Because say we have a computer over there, which is very expensive. However, only one program can run. Okay. So then we get involved. Yeah, so basically we want to see that if we have a computer over there, can we run multiple programs at the same time? For example, we can use this to run Word at the same time. I also want to run web browser, right? Something like that, okay? Okay, then we have issue. We have to load multiple processes in memory. Then if we only have one CPU core, then we have to execute one process for a short while, then switch process between them in memory. Then this can help us to better utilize our computer, right? However, we do have issue, right? Protection, how to protect? For example, you can see here from this example, suppose in total we have 512 kilobytes memory space. Then you can see we run operating system from 0 to 64 kilobytes. Then we have some free space here, and so on. Then we run ABC here. You can see ABC here. Okay. So sometimes it's because mistake. For example, we are programmer, right? We make mistake, right? So we generate bugs, okay? Yeah, we are proud to generate because that can help us to like generate more jobs, right? Yeah, it's not our intention, but sometimes it does happen. So programs process C, you can see here, maybe can override, then change the code for the process B, something like that, right? Or can read the data related to the process B. Okay, so if this is related to my bank account, okay, this process is dealing my bank account, then this is not good news, right? So generally speaking, then we have to provide the protection, okay? So from this kind of program, you can see that every time when we run a program, it may be loaded into the different place in physical memory. Okay. Then when we design when we write our program, it's desirable. We don't need to worry about physical space because every time physical space may be different. Okay. So this is why we prefer, from a programmer perspective, we prefer we have an abstraction for the physical. Okay. So basically, for each process, we want to have an address space. Okay. Simply speaking, you can think about this is a kind of a virtual space. When we generate a program, when we compile, when we generate when we do the compilation, when we generate executable program, we want to have a address space, virtual address space. Basically, our program can be arranged like this. Okay, for example, suppose we can have a 16 kilobytes address space. In the beginning, we put some programs and code data here, so which is our code and the data. Then we have heap. Heap is related to dynamic allocated data when we use malloc. Then at the bottom, we have stack. Stack will go up, the heap is go down, something like that. Okay. So if we give this kind of abstraction for programmer, when we do compilation, we generate our code based on this virtual space. Then basically, for every program, you just compile like this. Okay, so you don't need to worry about, where to allocate my program. So what is that specific physical location? If we need programmer to consider the physical location to be allocated in order to run a program, it's so difficult. No one can handle it. Okay, because every time that location is different, right? Okay, so anyway, so this is why we want to introduce this address space. Okay, so when we do the compilation, when we generate a process, we just follow this. Okay, particularly we have a code, it's our program code here, our instruction, right? We have data, we may have global or static local variable. Those variable will be put into a data session. Then we have heap, which is we use malloc in C or new in Java, right? Dynamic allocated memory. So we have stack, which will store the return address and the local variable when we call a routine or function. So to give you an example, so this is a real example from Linux implementation. So basically in Linux process called a task, you can see here, a task here. This is task structure inside. Actually, when we introduce process, we also talk about this memory, MM. We have point to this structure, memory management structure here. So you can see here from this memory structure, it allocate, it define our address space. You can see that where is our code segment, where is our data segment, where is our BSS segment, where is our heap segment, where is our memory map segment, where is our stack segment. Okay, so more specifically, concept wise, you can look at this figure. Basically, you can see here our Test segment is for our program code, program instruction. Data, basically we have initialized data and put into data segment. BSS is used to hold those uninitialized data. Okay. Then we have heap here. Then we have stack. In between, if you want to say you want to map a file into the memory, then you can do it. Okay, use a memory map. So, but generally speaking, you can see that this part is our stack, this part is our heap, this part is our program code and data. Okay. So to give you more example, suppose we want to run a very simple program here. You can see that we want to print out the location of the code. Then basically, we want to look at main function. So where is what is the address of the main function when we allocate? And so we want to print out this address. And then where's our location of the heap? Because we do the malloc the one byte, then malloc will return the address. Okay, we want to print out that address. Then inside this function, main function, we also declare a variable x. Then we want to print out where is this local variable allocated, because we know local variable will be allocated in the stack. Okay, then basically this is a simple program. We want to print out the address. Particularly, this is related to the code, right? This is related to heap. This is related to the stack. Okay, you can see here. So this is our, this is from a 64-bit Linux machine. Then it print out the address. You can see here, basically, the code is from here. So you can see it's somewhere here. So in the beginning, our address start from this 400 or something. Okay. Then we have some data, which is our global data and so on. Initialize and initialize. Then we go to the heap. Heap is start from CF2000. Then you can see when we do this malloc, then basically we return somewhere from here, right? Okay. Then our heap is here. You can see here. Okay. Generally speaking, that's our address space. Okay, so to show you more example, okay, so let me go back to the my virtual machine, then print out the process image, then you give you more example. Okay, so can you guys see my virtual machine screen? Okay, now I have a very simple program here. You can see that this program did nothing, only sleep. So basically sleep 100 milliseconds, then return, okay? So because if we want to print out the image of a process, we have to make the program to run, right? So basically we want to make this program run 100 milliseconds. So we have enough time to display his body, right? Something like that. Okay, so because I already run it, so let me directly show you those command. The first command is we can go to the PROC system subsystem, then For each running process, then we can look at the image. Particularly, you show the, we have to run it first, okay? Yeah, so I already generated. So let me generate again. Test.c, okay? So I want to run it, background, then it show me 2-1, this is the PID here, okay? So in order to look at, in order to look at this process memory map, we can go to PROC system, cat PROC, no such 214, yes, okay. 21469, right? Okay, you can see here. Basically, this part is related to our first we have some read the write execution. Now this one is a private or share flag. So this is our code segment. Okay. This part is related to our data segment. We have two, right? Maybe it's a one is for our data segment, another one is for BSS, uninitialized. Now here, there's no heap, okay? Then you can see this part is for our shared library. When we call some program in our library, basically we will load those program into this area. So those library will be loaded into this area, okay? So other part is a stack here. Okay, generally speaking, that's how we show the image of a process, okay? Another command we can use is, we can use this one, pmap. Process map to print out. Okay. Similarly, this one is pmap hyphen x, then print out input PID. Okay, this is done already. So let's try again. Then with a different number, 21474. Okay. So you can see that we pretty much show the same information. You can see here we have we also have the size and so on, right? So basically this is our code segment. This is our data segment, okay? This one is our BSS segment. Then this is a part of shared library. This is our stack, let's see, okay? Something like that, okay? So if you want to know more, please go ahead, okay, to try, okay? How could you tell which one is, yeah, because basically, as I mentioned, address space is determined, okay? So from a, of course, we can see it from the flag here, but generally speaking, this is a determined when we design our process. So address space is kind of a fix the structure. So in the beginning, we have a code segment. You can see here, X means execution. So basically this segment, this part is for execution. So this is why this part is our code segment. Okay, so similarly for other part, but generally speaking, this is a defined. Okay, this is not we only display the information here, but the structure actually is defined already with our task. You can see here. Okay, you can see here. So when we create a process, when we allocate those space, we already define. Okay, in the beginning, this is the text segment. This is the data part. This is the BSS part. This is the heap part. This is the stack part. Okay. So then when we create, we generally speaking, we go to the executable program, then load our program into this part. Then the data, some uninitialized global variable here, then set up our stack. That's it. Okay. Yeah, load some so this part is those shared library, so mapped into this area, then set up the heap. You can see that we have start break and end break. Then that system called break help us to extend our heap region, something like that. Okay. Why the I got some questions. So maybe I will discuss with you about those issues later, okay, related to some details. Okay, so let me continue to finish the lecture, then I will go back to answer some questions. So next topic I want to talk about is address translation. Okay. So we talk about this limited direct execution when we talk about process in the beginning, right? But over there, basically, we talk about some privileged mode. So generally speaking, we divide the whole mode into basically, right, two modes, right? Kernel mode, user mode, then user program can only run at user space. Then if they want to utilize the service, then they can trap into the kernel. Then kernel can execute those privileged instructions and so on, right? So, similarly, we also need to limit direct execution. This is mainly for the protection. Okay, memory space must be isolated. If we cannot isolate it, then your process, your code can touch my data, or my code can read your data. That's not secure, right? So, in order to provide this kind of limited direct execution, then we do need hardware support. Later, we'll talk about TLB, page table, and so on. But generally speaking, we want to isolate those address space. Okay? So the first part, this part, when we talk about, this is a kind of a concept. Okay? So basically, we want to see that. You can see here, in the beginning, we want to, when we create the process, we do have an image here. So each part, we have some address space here. Say for the text, where is our text? Where is our data? Where is the heap and so on, right? Then through this page table mapping, so later we'll talk about this, okay? Don't worry about this one, but generally speaking, we want to have a mapping table. We have mapping that maps this virtual address space, which is our address space. Right now, everything is virtual. Okay? Our virtual space into the physical space. Okay? So this will be clear. But generally speaking, right now we want to see that how to do this kind of mapping, how to map from our virtual address space into our physical memory, because physical memory is over there. Think about that. We only have, for example, you have 4 gigabytes physical memory. That's it, okay? However, we can run multiple process. We may have K processes, or each one have address space, okay? How to map, right? The question is that how to map into this physical space. So that's the question we want to solve. Okay, so let's say, let's see what's the problem here. So first is we have to relocation address space. So in our virtual address space, actually our address always start at address zero. However, we may place this process anywhere in physical memory, right? So then how to handle that, right? That's first issue, right? So this go to a very simple approach called base and bound approach, okay? For example, our address space is from 0 to 16 kilobytes, okay? This is determined. So in the beginning, so which means, okay, when we generate a process, this address space is determined already, okay? Basically, maximum is 16 kilobytes, suppose. Okay, then we have some part is a program code, then we have heap, then we have stack. Then you can see that because the total space to run this process is 16 kilobytes, then we can find 16 kilobytes in physical memory. For example, starting from 32 kilobytes, then end at 48 kilobytes, then basically we can load this program into this part, this process into this part, physical map. This is our physical map. Yeah. Okay, so then if we use a base and a bound regulator, this can be easily achieved. The idea is very simple. Okay, so when we run a process, we just put a base register to record where is the starting physical address for my process. And for example, in this case, I use a base register to record 32 kilobytes, okay? Then another parameter we need to put is the length or bound, okay? So basically our address space for this example is 16 kilobytes. So you can see that when we set up those both numbers, then we are okay. With this base and the bound, then no matter what kind of program we can run, as long as you follow my address space definition, okay, then I set up the base and the bound. For example, you see this base is, I can load this program into any place to run. For example, 48, right? I just change the base register, that's it, right? So that's why we want to use the base and the bound. So why we need a bound register? Think about that. So we want to do the isolation. So in this way, you cannot touch other process space because we have bound, and we can check easily check the bound. We can see, oh, this address is out of bound. So this is why it's called bound resolution, right? Okay, then when we write our program, when we compile our program, we can generate the virtual address space. As we mentioned before, it always starts from zero and so on. Then when we run our program, we can load this program into anywhere. Then this is the setup based on the bound. So remember the fundamental program model in Feynman architecture is a memory address, right? So we have to load the store from memory or fetch instruction from memory. So we need to know the address, right? So when we fetch instruction from memory, when we load the data or store data to memory or load the data from the memory, that address must be the physical address. It cannot be a virtual address. So whenever we want to have some real stuff, it must be physical. Otherwise, we cannot get our data and our instructions, right? So the question is that, how can we generate this physical address after we load our program into a particular location, physical location, right? So basically, this is we call dynamic relocation. So when program start to running, then we can decide where this physical memory should be loaded. Okay, so this is a dynamic. Why this is dynamic? So that means that when we run a program, its physical location is not fixed. It can be loaded into anywhere as long as we have enough space. Okay. Then through the base register, after we set up, after we say, oh, we find enough space, then put this program into a specific location, start from a base address, then we set up a base register. Then for each address relate to this program, let me run. But simply speaking, you can think about, okay, what is fundamental computation model for our Feynman architecture? Think about that, okay? Basically, if you understand this, then you will know that our computer model is very simple. So basically, we have to know the address of instruction or data, right? Then we fetch the instruction into our CPU, then do instruction cycle. Or we have to know the address of our data. So we can either load the data into our register or store back into a particular address, right? So our program, you think about it, our program actually is just to do this kind of stuff. Basically, our program is that, our program is here, loading into here. Then when we executed those instructions one by one, okay, our program, generally speaking, is to load the data into the register, then do some calculation, use ALU, then store the result back into the memory address. Okay, that's our program model. So this is the one. We have to generate the physical memory address. Okay, address is important, right? So how to generate? Simple. For all our program, we can use virtual address. Then plus the base address, then we get the physical address. Base here is our base register. So based on this base register, then we can get the physical address. Okay, simple, right? Then, of course, we have a typo here. So we also want to make sure that virtual address should be greater than or equal to zero or smaller than bound. Okay. So otherwise, this is out of bound. Then we can generate a segment fault. Let's see, okay, something wrong here. So we provide the isolation. Okay. So, yeah, a candidate. Okay, already 315. Okay, so yeah, let me finish this part. Then we can have a break. So here we talk about two way to set up this bound register. Either we can say this is the size of the address space. Then basically we will compare with the size, or we can make the physical address of the end of the address space. Okay, for example, if we load at 32, if the bound is 16, then basically the maximum physical address is 48 kilobytes. So if we over this one, then basically say, oh, sorry, this is not correct. Okay, this is the auto bound, something like that. Okay. To give you an example, right? So maybe I talk about this example after the break. But the general idea, you can see it's a very simple idea. We have baseline bound, then utilize this one. Then basically we can load our address space into anywhere. And also provide the isolation. Right? So that's the method, the first method we use. Okay? But in reality, actually, we don't use this method now. Okay, so because it caused a lot of issues. So anyway, okay, so I guess we can have a break. So let me post the, yes, let me, where is, okay, let me post the recording. Yeah, I see during the break I look at the chat box, I find several questions. So maybe let me first go to talk about those questions related to the address space. Then I will go back to the lecture. Okay, how could you tell which one is in the code segment, which one is in data segment? Okay, so as I mentioned, okay, this is defined by OS. Okay, so we do have a text, task structure. Then inside you can look at this process memory allocation, right? Memory virtual space. Okay, so of course, if you look at those flags, you can see that basically X relate to the execution. I think one student also mentioned this one, right? So maybe we can utilize that to see, oh, this is a code segment. But generally speaking, this is a defined already, okay? Another question is related to what is the RSS and the dirty? So, I don't know what is the RSS, and also dirty maybe is because we already have some, we already update the this segment, okay, this part. So, but sorry, I don't know those details. Please help me. So go back to check the PMAP and also relate to the memory map of a process, then you can you should know this after you spend some time. Okay. Okay. So why does PMAP Yingho ask another very good question? So which I don't know. So. So I have to utilize this one. See, okay, please study this by yourself. Okay, so Yeah, so this question is related to the, does the pmap and the cat command print out the virtual memory? Yes, this exactly. So this is the virtual address. Okay, everything we talk about here is virtual address. Okay, everything we can print out is virtual address. Okay. Yeah, continuous. I don't know this question here. So what is the question? Continuous. Yeah, I think maybe I look at the chat box. I remember the question related to that. When we use the base and bound approach, so the physical memory space required must be continuous. I guess that's the question, right? So yes, so this is a limitation for this method, but we have to satisfy this requirement. So all physical memory space must be continuous, okay? Because we allocate the whole address space. Okay, I guess that's all questions. Any other questions before we continue? Can you guys hear me clearly? Yeah, everything okay? More questions? Do you have more questions? I don't think so. I think Liu Jianfu asked, are we able to display actual memory address? We cannot do that. But if you go to the kernel, definitely we should know this information, but at the user level, maybe we don't allow you to print out this physical memory address for security issue, right? So we don't want to know the real physical address. Okay, so let me go back to our slides. Okay, so yeah, because I use my iPad to log in also, so I can see whether or not you guys can see. So now I only need to guarantee you can hear me clearly. So yes, we talked about this base and bound, right? You can see this is a very simple idea. Then the good thing here is that, as we mentioned before, if for our program, we have a fixed address space here, then it's very easy for the programmer. So we don't need to worry about the physical location. This program, when it run to be allocated. So we only need to worry about virtual space. Okay, it just follows the kind of a convention to arrange our program when we do the compilation, to arrange our program, where is our code and so on. Then when we generate our process image, also follow this convention, then generate. Okay, to give an example. Okay, suppose we have a program. The same program, then this is our physical memory. We have how many? 6 kilobytes physical memory. Then each process, when we run this program, load the program into here, you can see from the first one is from one kilo to 2 kilo. Then the second one is from 4 to 5. They are the same code. However, we want to run two processes, right? So P1 and P2, okay? So after we load this, first we run P1, okay? Then we run P2, okay? So that's a situation we want to put here, okay? Yeah. Then suppose you can see here, this is our virtual address, this is our physical address. Okay. For example, in our program, we have a code is load 100 into the register R1. Okay, so 100 is our virtual address. From our virtual address space, 100. Okay, so because our base actually is, remember our base register, we already set up. When we load this program, our base register is 1 kilo, 1024. Okay, so remember, when we generate our physical address, we will put this virtual address plus base address. So our physical address will load from 1124. Okay, so somewhere here. So we load this data, okay, into the register, which is inside our CPU. Okay. Then because P1 and P2 run same code, suppose now we switch to P2 to run the same code. We want to load 100 also into the R1. So because they have the same code, right? However, the physical, the base address of P2 base, right? We have base now, okay, base register, right? Base here, yeah. Okay. So base is 4 kilo, which is 4096. So plus 100, this is our virtual address. Then we get the physical address, 4196. Okay, so perfectly, okay, we go to the different place to load our instruction to run. Then similarly, P2 now want to load 1000 to R1, then plus the base, then go to the 5096 and so on, right? Then we, if we want to run P1 from 1000, then physical address, remember our base is 1024, then plus 1000. So we get 2024, okay? So, question here is that can P2 hurt P1? Can P1 hurt P2? For example, P1 say, okay, now I want to store data from R1, right? So this is inside of CPU. So after we calculate, okay, you owe me $1 million, right? Now I want to store this result back into the location, okay? Make the fact you owe me $1 million, right? So the address is, this is virtual address, okay? 3072 plus our base 1024. Now you can see this value is 4096. It's here, right? Let's go to the code here. Go to the address space of P2, right? Basically, if we don't put any bound, then if we allow the process to write to anywhere, then certainly we may cause some security issue. Okay, so this is why you can see for each process, we also need to put a bound register, right? So then after we have the bound register, it's very simple. Now, if you want to run this one, I will see that you want to run this virtual address. You want to store to this virtual address, 3072, right? I will check this number. Is that out of bound? Our bound is, suppose our bound is 1024 in this case. Okay, then I say, oh, this address is greater than 1024. Sorry, okay. Then here, we will generate exception. Then this is from the hardware. Hardware will generate exception. Then exception handle will say, okay, we have some out of bound exception. So we have a program to handle it, Okay, we jump to a particular code inside the operating system to handle this kind of exception. Now, basically, this cannot be successfully executed. Okay, then we provide the protection, right? So something like that, okay? So is this clear based on the bond, how it works? Huh? Any questions for base and bound? Can you guys hear me? Yeah, the question, Inso asked a question. So we don't need to worry about this. OS will handle it. I guess the question relates to the mapping, right? Where to allocate to the physical address? Yes, okay. Our operating system will handle this allocation, right? Yes. Right. And also, if your question relates to the protection here, basically after we set up this base and bound, the hardware will handle this, okay? If this is auto bound, then we will generate an exception. This is the hardware exception. So, then operating system will handle this. Through this exception, we have exception handler, then operating system will handle this. Okay, then basically, this cannot be successfully executed. Okay, yeah, so operating system need to handle several issues, must take action to implement based on the bound approach, okay? So basically, when a process start running, then we have to allocate the address space, then set up base and bound, right? Find the physical space. This is the physical space for this virtual space in physical memory. Then set up a base and bound. If we find, then we set up base on properly, okay? Then certainly, if auto bound, then we have to handle this. Okay, here we didn't mention this, but generally speaking, we have to handle this, right? So if we have exception occurs, then we have to handle this situation. Okay. Usually we just terminate this process. Then show you some segment fault or auto bound kind of error message. So when a process is terminated, we have to reclaim the memory back for you. Because see, okay, this process is finished. So we have to, in the beginning, we allocate. This is the first step to allocation. Now we have to reclaim, then we can reuse those memory space, okay? Then when we run multiple processes, when context switch occurs, then we have to save the sleep process base and bound and restore the running one to be run one, right? So basically save and store the base and bound. Okay. So let's look at the first issue, okay? So how to handle the first issue? Usually we have a kind of a free list. Then we just remember all those free space. For example, in this case, we may have, you can see here, our free space is 16 to 32. Then we have to remember, start from here, 16 kilobytes. So then what is the length correspondingly? Okay, then starting from 48 kilobytes, what is the length? Okay, then after we run a new process, then we can allocate some space, okay, for a particular process to run. Okay, so in this case, suppose, okay, in the beginning, we have a operating system already occupied this one. Then process A is occupied 32 to 48. Then basically our free list is from 16 kilobytes. Then the length is 16 and 48 length is also 16 kilo, right? So after we free this, then we put this back. Okay, you can see here, starting from 32 kilo, then we have a 16 kilo, right? So look at this one. Any issue here? You can see actually our free space, you can see here, this is our free space. This is a continuous space here, right? So basically to manage this free list, we have to co-list them together. Then basically we'll say starting from 16 kilobytes. Now the size is 48, right? This is different from this one, okay? Because if we have a process which require bigger address space, then we can allocate space, okay? Otherwise, this one actually, you can see each part is 16, right? So this is different. So to manage this free space actually is not that easy, okay? So use this base and bound. Sooner or later, we will have a lot of hole here. Yeah, I didn't put here, but you can see that we may have a hole here, right? This is some free space. This is some free space, okay? This is the allocation because after release, then we will have some hole here. Then this may cause some issue. So we have to do some we call memory compaction and so on. So to make the free space to be put together and so on, yeah. Okay, second, when we do the, if we run multiple processes, okay, you can see here, basically, we can, if we, in the beginning, we run this process A, then the base bound, base is 32 kilobytes. Then later when we run B, then we have to switch, right? Basically we save A's one, then go to run B's, okay? Something like that, okay? So then this, to save and restore the base and the bound. This is the one for when we do the scheduling, we have to set up those base and bound properties. Okay. So generally speaking, that's a base and bound approach. This is the most fundamental concept related to the memory allocation, memory management. Okay, so based on this one, I will show you later, we talk about segment-based approach, okay? This method is very simple. So give a virtual address space, then just use a base and bound. Then if we don't have enough space, we have to wait until we have enough continuous space. So that's the problem, okay? But even for this one, after we have user mode, kernel mode, it become complicated in reality, okay, in practice, okay. So remember I show you, some material. Yeah, so in the here, let me show you. So if you guys want to really know this, please go to this part. We have a simple simulator we developed. We also step by step. In the beginning, we have a very simple simulator. Then later, we make, we end the interrupt. Then we go to the, we end the user mode and kernel mode. Then later, we end the base and the bound. Okay. We also use the assembly to write a simple operating system to handle those issues. For example, to when we have base and bound, when we have user mode, kernel mode, and then how to do the scanning and so on. So, if you want to know, really understand it, right? So suppose that if this auto bound, what happened? So we add the exception, right? So this is a kind of like, you know, the if you understand this part, then you know the hardware, also the software, okay? So please go to this part to really understand how we do scheduling, how we do base and bound, how we handle exception. Okay. Of course, if you do the real operation, for example, XV6, it definitely will help you. Okay. So utilize this chance, I also want to tell you that I already released the lottery and the stripe scheduling. So if you are interested in those scheduling algorithm, please go to read this dissertation. Then this paper from SIGMODE 2021 talk about utilize stripe scheduling to implement some transaction scheduling. Okay, so you can see this is a very new paper from last year SIGMODE. Okay, so okay, I just want to show you. Okay, if you want to do research, then basically this is a okay, yeah. So, now let me I notice there are some questions. So let me go back to answer some questions. Yeah, first let me stop sharing. Then let me go back to. Let me copy some questions here. Is that a kind of a memory management fault? So I guess this is related to the exception, right? So out of bound, right? So basically this is a hardware exception. If it's out of bound, then automatically we'll generate this exception. Then we already, so generally speaking, we have some mechanism, okay? When we have this kind of exception, then we have some fixed program, which is inside our operating system kernel, then will be used to handle this kind of exception, okay? But exception is a hardware. We have this hardware mechanism to generate the exception. So I guess the last question relate to that, can this bound to be changed dynamically? I don't understand this question. So what do you mean dynamic change? Can the student, Ken Long, can you help clarify the question? Like when the heap is used up? No, yeah, so So are you talking about like resize the process space, something like that? Yeah, so yeah, I understand the question. So basically you see that when we use up the space, right? So first thing, okay, in reality, no one uses one, okay? Base and bound. First, in practice, no one uses it, okay? So from concept perspective, right, we cannot do that because we already determined the address space, okay? So maybe you will ask, okay, so if no one uses space and bound, why we want to talk about this space and bound, right? Okay, so because we will talk about segment, okay? Segment basically is based on the base and bound, okay? Segment actually is used by Intel. Okay. Yeah, so base and bound, generally speaking, is mapped to our virtual space one-to-one, right? So this is why you cannot change it. You change it, that means, okay, you want to change the virtual space, but the virtual space has to be determined in the beginning. So you cannot, certainly from the hardware perspective, if you want to change that base bound register value, of course we can do it. But from concept perspective, we cannot do that. Because now you want to change the virtual space dynamically. But in the beginning, we have to determine this, right? So we cannot do that. Okay. I hope I answer your question. Okay, so so let me continue to talk about segmentation, okay, and paging. Okay. So this is a more practical. Basically, now let's go to more practical approach to handle the okay, yeah, great, okay. So can you guys hear me clearly? Huh? Yeah, just want to get some response actually. Okay, so let's go to memory management. Okay, so now let's go to some new method called segmentation. Base and bound, I think maybe you guys already realized, right? This may not be a good approach, right? For example, suppose my address space is 16 kilobytes. Then in the beginning, my code only occupy 2 kilobytes, suppose, okay, in this case. Then, of course, I have some data here. Suppose I have some data here. Then heap here, actually, I already reserved some space. However, we also have some free space here from the stack and here. Then you can see that we do have some free space here. However, if we want to use base and bound, we have to find the continuous physical space for this 16 kilobyte. Otherwise, we cannot run this. Okay. Those space maybe need to be used or may not be used. But we have to allocate the space, okay? So suppose we don't have enough physical memory, then basically we cannot run. Okay, so this is an inefficiency of a base and bound approach. Okay? So when we have a small address space, it's still okay. For example, suppose we only have 16 kilobytes. virtual address space is still okay. However, right now our program occupies a lot of space. Our virtual space, if we talk about process Linux process in IE32 architecture, virtual space is 4 gigabytes. Okay. No matter you need or not, we will give you 4 gigabytes. It's virtual address, right? So when we generate our, when we compile our program, we follow this one. When we generate a process, we follow this one. Okay. Then look at this huge virtual space. If we really use word base and bound, it's impossible. No matter how big your memory space it is, it's maybe like 64 gigabytes, I think it's already huge, right? But you can only run very few processes at the same time. It's impossible to do this. So we have to have a more efficient method to do the memory allocation. Okay, so this is why people invent segmentation method. Basically, the idea here is that if the whole space, you can see the whole space here, whole virtual space is too huge to be allocated. How about we just allocate the program data stack and so on. So we only allocate for each segment, each part. Then basically we can save the space. Okay. So this is why base and bound are useful. We use the base and bound for each segment. Then each segment is a contiguous portion of the address space of particular length. Then logically, we have a code segment, stack segment, heap segment. Then for each segment, we just have a base and bound. Okay, code segment, we have base and bound. Stack segment, we have base and bound. Heap segment, we have base and bound. That's it, okay? Then after we have this base and bound for each segment can be placed into different parts of the physical memory. Okay. Think about that. Before, when we have this whole physical space, we use one base and bound. Then we must use continuous space. And program, heap, stack must be put together into one continuous physical space. However, right now, if we separate into three set components, then each component can be put into a different physical space. So that's the idea, okay? Give you an example. Suppose we have a process. Our code segment, the size is 2 kilo. Heap is 2 kilo. Stack is 2 kilo. Okay. Then you can see that right now we can allocate the code segment into 32K, for example, here, right? Heap can be into 34. Okay. Then stack can be into 28. However, this is a go up or something like that. Okay. But generally speaking, this is we only need 6 kilobytes, then we can run a process. Okay. So basically, that's why we want to use segmentation. Okay. We don't need to allocate the whole virtual space. Okay, so as I mentioned before, one of the most important issue is how to generate the physical memory address. based on this Feynman architecture, we have to know how to generate physical memory address based on the virtual address. Okay, so suppose inside our code segment, okay, then we have an offset is 100, okay, 100 here, virtual address is 100. This is a virtual address, okay? So then now, because we use a segment-based approach, right? So we have to look at our code segment. What is our base address? 32 kilo, okay? So what is the bound? 2 kilo. Then basically for each offset from our virtual address, then we generate corresponding base. Here, the base, because this is inside our code segment, so the base is 32 kilo. So basically, this is 100 plus 32 kilo. Oh, this number is our physical address. Okay, then we just load here from to generate, to load this instruction into our CPU. Okay. So it's very similar to base and bound. However, now we have given each virtual address, we have to first look at for this virtual address, where this located. Is this in code segment or this is in clip segment? Okay. So another example, now we have the virtual address offset is 4,200. Our, suppose inside our virtual address space, our heap start from 4 kilo, okay? Then we have to, because here we have to know the offset inside our heap, because our heap is allocated into physical memory based on this base address register. So given each virtual address, now we have to generate the offset inside this segment. Okay, so basically we will know, because the virtual inside our virtual address, our heap start from 4 kilo. Then this virtual address for 4,200. So 4,200 minus 4,096. Then basically we get the offset is 104. Okay. Then our starting address now, physical address here, from our mapping table here, is 34 kilo. So our physical address is 104 plus 34 k. It's something like that. Yeah. So certainly base and bound can help us to provide protection. So if an illegal address, for example, 7 kilobytes, which is beyond the heap, right now our heap is 2 kilobytes, right? Then we have segment fault, segmentation fault, okay? Because hardware will, oh, this is out of bound, then generate the exception. Then we will say, to handle it, then tell you, oh, this is out of bound, segmentation fault, something like that, right? Okay, so base and bound works. Then how to implement, okay? So, this is a particular for this example, okay? But in reality, we also have, for example, in IA32, Intel process 32 architecture, we have this kind of segmentation. We utilize this segmentation approach, okay? So generally speaking, address space, virtual address, and when we talk about this address space, we always talk about virtual address. So virtual address, okay. Given a virtual address, Remember, now we have to generate the physical address because this will be mapped into part of the physical address, right? So we have to look at this mapping here, right? Segment, this is a mapping table. Basically, code segment is where is the code segment located, heap, stack, and so on, right? So then, basically, we can, given the address, now we can separate, okay, into the different segment and the offset, okay. Then given this address, then we look at where is our code segment, where is our heap segment, where is our stack segment, okay. So because we only have three segments here, so we can use two bits to represent this, okay. So the most significant two bits can be used to represent can be used to determine which segment, okay. Then this part, our virtual address can be used as offset inside this segment, okay, something like that, right? Of course, this one basically is determined by our address space. So when we define each segment, actually we already see this base and bound, then we can utilize that to determine this virtual address and so on. So this is only example, but generally speaking, you can see that we can either use software or hardware to implement this. Okay, remember, given a virtual address, we have to translate this into the physical address. Then how to do that? So generally speaking, we have to go to our mapping table here to find the base address, then use this base address plus our offset, then we can generate the physical address, right? So then you can see here, basically this, suppose our address space is defined like this way, okay? So we use the most significant two bits to represent the segment selector. Then this part is our offset. Then our address will generate like this way. You, for each virtual address, then we will first do AND operation with this a mask bit. So generally speaking, you can see here. So if you look at the binary here, then because this is a AND operation, right? So for AND operation, if we AND one number, okay, one bit AND zero, so what is the result? AND zero, right? Suppose this is the one, oh, zero, right? Because we are talking about bit, right? So no matter this is a one, input is one or zero, the result should be zero, right? After we end. So you can see here, the purpose here is that given this virtual address, we want to just get the most significant two bits after we do this end operation. Then we get the topmost two bits, then do the shifting, shift 12 bits. So generally speaking, we want to get the segment selector here, right? So use this two bit, then we go to this table to find out, okay, where is our base address, then other part as the offset, okay? So offset, similarly for this virtual address, then we go to the offset mask. Offset mask is a offset. So basically, we remove the first two bits, then keep those least significant 14 bits as offset. Then we get the offset. Then look at this offset, whether or not this is in the bound. If this is out of bound, then there is an exception. Okay. Otherwise, we generate physical address based on this our mapping table, then plus offset, then we can access the data from the memory. Right. Okay. So generally speaking, this is how we implement. Okay. So I noticed there are some questions. Okay, I want to stop here. Then tomorrow I will talk about the stack, but generally speaking, stack is a different direction, right? So, and also some sharing and so on. So most important, I will finish the paging, okay, which is commonly used right now, okay? So time is up, around, okay. So basically I will go back to answer some questions, but if you have other things, you need to leave, it's okay. Yeah, so this is the end of the lecture already. So let me go back to answer some questions. So first question I think is, why do we need to the end when we shift right away? Yeah, I think this depends on the different instruction. So usually we need to generate this one, then we do shift. But see, if in some architecture you have assembly instruction, then you load this one, you load this virtual address into a register, then you can directly do the shifting. I think it's also okay. But here we don't want to change the original value, right? So we want to kind of do this operation, then shift, right? We don't want to change the original value. I think that basically that's the reason, maybe. But those are implementation issue, okay? So it's if we don't need this, then we can directly do shift, then please do it, right? Maybe let me copy those questions. Yeah, so in this way, you guys can have a better view. Yeah, this, as I mentioned, this implementation issue. So yeah, if in the architecture we don't need this, then please do it. But generally speaking, we want to get the purpose. You know, the purpose is okay, right? The purpose, we want to get the segment selector, which is the topmost two bits. Right, so this is why we want to do this. Okay, so what happened to the segment when the stack or heap is extended? Then you have to, if you want to do extension, we have to set up our bound, right? Our bound register. Right, correspondingly. So set our bounds for each segment for the corresponding segment. It's not a corresponding segment. So I think the last question, Ken Long's question is that is this a mapping for each process? What do you think? Yeah, for base bound, basically we have two. For each process, we should have one, right? So similarly for this one, we also need to have one. Otherwise we cannot, this segment actually, yes, each process should have such a mapping table, right? So because here, we need to utilize this to map to the physical address. For each process, we have different value to map into a different location, right? So this is you think about it, this is just the extension from the base and the bound, right? But now for more fine-grained granularity. Something like that, okay. Yeah, I hope I answer your question. This mapping table is stored in each process. This mapping table is basically, each process should have one mapping table, but yeah, for each process inside our process kernel data structure, we should store this mapping table, right? For each process, yeah. Inside the kernel data structure for each process, we should store this mapping table. Yeah. Okay, so anything else? No more questions? Okay, thank you guys. See you tomorrow.